1, 2, 3, 4. Steve Gorman, thank you so much for joining me today to talk.
Yeah, no worries, man. Happy to do it.
So I have to be honest, I've been a fan of the Crows since 90. I just moved from New Orleans to Atlanta, and it was my first year in high school. I was in 10th grade, and I went and saw you guys at Center Stage Theater with a band called Rockin' Bones. I don't know if you remember that.
Oh, yeah. No, they were friends of ours from back in the day. And yeah, I remember that was like in the fall of 90. We were probably out with Heart at the time, or so it was like a day off on a tour. We were either out with Heart or Robert Plant when that gig happened, I think, if memory serves.
Yeah, I know I saw you guys with Heart at Lakewood. And I don't
It was around that same time. I don't think it was much earlier than that. But I don't know. But I do remember playing Center Stage with Rockin' Bones for sure.
That was one of the moments that I was like 16. And at that time, you know, as a music lover and as a musician, I feel like that's when you're starting to kind of get your bearings a little bit and kind of actually kind of look for music that's a little more substantial as opposed to now. I mean, I was totally into glam and hard rock and metal, which I still enjoy, you know, but the Crows were a special band, and the Crows kind of became a gateway band in a sense for me, because that was what opened the doors for me to go listen to a lot of classic music. Was that something that you were prepared to be a part of at the time, or did you even know it was going to happen?
Oh, no. I mean, that's not, we didn't think about things in those terms at all. I mean, people would say, initially we were playing already by that time. We would do, you know, covers by some more obscure artists. You know, people were saying things like, oh, I never listened to Graham Parsons until I heard you guys do one of his songs, or, you know, even playing Big Star before we would come out on stage, you know, people say, what's that band? You know, but that's any band does that. You get out and you start to put your taste across, and curious fans will ask you what those things are. In terms of being like an actual link to a prior generation of music, though, if you're thinking about that kind of stuff when you're 24, you're missing the whole point. You know what I mean? That's because that's not our job. It's the listener's job to take that and run with it like you did. You know, our job was to be present and be looking forward. Now, you know, it's important to look back. If you don't know where you're coming from, then you don't know where you can go, as they say.
Right.
But to answer your question shortly, no. I mean, that's just, there's so many things that happen around the band and to a band and for a band that you can't plan or predict, you know, in both good and bad ways. And that's certainly one of those things.
I think as musicians in general, especially in our younger, you know, formidable years or whatever, like we're not even thinking about things like impact or whatever. We're kind of like, oh man, I just get to play music. This is cool. Whoever likes it, fuck, let them in.
I mean, I can tell you that gig you referenced. I mean, I remember it. Rockin' Bones, they were friends of ours, like friendly rival band in town, you know? But I mean, we were going to play Center Stage, you know, our record had come out and it was doing well, and we got the headline and we knew it was going to sell out, and we asked them to open for us too. I mean, like, we friendly rivals, but ultimately friendly. And it's like, oh, let's get Rockin' Bones to play this show with us. And so that was our way of, you know, hey guys, this will be cool. But what I remember as far as impact goes was, you know, we had been on the road for a few months by that point. Like we were a touring band. The last time we had seen Rockin' Bones, we were just a local band like they were. And so to show up after 4 or 5 straight months of playing every night, suddenly we were on a whole different level. And the guys in Rockin' Bones were like, whoa, like they were like in shock. And so much so that there was no artifice. There was no trying to be cool. They were just like, holy crap, like, fellas, what the hell is this, you know? And it was a really cool moment. only be, you know, we thought we were getting better. We thought we were doing something, but for those guys to just acknowledge it. And again, mm-hmm. it was common sense. Any band that plays for 4 months in a row every night, you're going to get a lot better. But what I remember is we all felt we were all really happy about that. Like, oh, okay. Cause you also, you know, we're charting our progress a day at a time. And they came in 4 or 5 months in one fell swoop. And it was obvious to them that something was happening with us, that we were turning into that kind of band we'd always wanted to be. And so that gig was important to us for that, just for that reason. Like, the crowd liked it, of course, you know, people like the music, but to have friends from another band acknowledge it, that really meant a lot to us.
Peer validation is something yeah. that sometimes means as much, if not more, than validation from, say, like an audience.
Well, of course. Oh, without question. Well, peer validation and then obviously validation from your heroes. And then over time, those guys become your peers, too. Right. Those are huge things. You know, just, and there's a million little moments along the way. Back when we were a local band and really weren't very good, but we would have these moments, or we would have a good song, you know, the right compliment from one person will keep you going for months. You know, literally, that's all it takes, is one little nudge from somebody you respect. You know, I had a lot of friends back when Shake Your Moneymaker blew up. They'd be like, well, I didn't want to, you know, they would not mention the band at all. Like, it just wouldn't come up. I'd see an old friend from college or something, and I'd finally go like, hey, so, you know, like, you know what's going on, right? You know, after a while, and they'd say, oh, I just didn't think you'd want to hear about it. You must be sick of it. And I'd always say the same thing, which is, no, I'm sick of hearing about it from strangers. I'd love to hear about it from people whose opinion I actually respect and care about, you know, it's that kind of thing. It's like,
right.
You know, but I mean, it's not like this is, you know, these are first world issues, of course, across the board. You're wondering why an old buddy isn't mentioning your band, you know, but but it's more like that, you know. So, but yeah, that peer validation, to your point, it's huge, especially, you know, confidence is 99% of live performance. You know, if confidence is everything, and so every little bit of that helps.
Some of the best bands that I, you know, some of my favorite bands and some of the best bands I've seen live, whether it be everybody from, you know, Iron Maiden to the Ramones to the Crows to the Stones, the best live bands. Hell, I just saw Ugly Kid Joe last week at Center Stage, and I've been a fan of theirs for years. It was their first tour in 27 years. But those guys knew how to work a crowd, you know? Mm-hmm. And so when I see how a band, there's that push and pull between the audience. Like, yeah. I'm giving you this. What are you going to give me back that's going to amp me up so I can give you more? You know, right. And that's a magical thing when that occurs live, even if it's just 5 or 6 people, you know, in a crowd. Yeah. You know, if you can capture 2 of them, man, I'm gold.
Well, that's and when you're an opening band, which at the time you first saw us, we were out. We had toured with Aerosmith. You know, that first year we had 3 big arena tours as an opener: Aerosmith, Heart, and Robert Plant. And that's when you really learn about that. It's like our manager, Pete, would say, you know, you don't have to get 10,000 people to like you. Get 100 people to like you. Like, find the two dudes already wearing your shirt in the 12th row who are out of their minds and just perform to them. You know, like, you're not here to win over the entire arena. You can't. So don't even try. Just find the people that are there and work it to them. You know, that's how you build something.
You've been doing press, obviously, for a long, long time. What is a question that you get asked so much that you die inside a little every time you get asked it?
I have no idea. I would have to. I mean, I'm sure if I weren't thinking about that, you know, there's probably a few right now. I mean, literally nothing comes to mind. I don't know. It's like there were probably times. I never, you know, I don't know that anything ever really did specifically wind me up, because I always approached it from like, well, whoever's asking me questions is doing their job, you know, and I tried not to get too personally involved in that, you know. I mean, as much as we can have a friendly conversation, you know, if you go back 30 years, it's like, they're not talking to me, they're talking to the drummer of the Black Crows. So I have to put that hat on. There is a little bit of a separation, you know, that just to remind yourself, you know. You know, I've done interviews all over the world where the person sits down and goes, okay, so what do you do in the band? That's their first question. And right away you're like, well, they were just assigned this story. They don't care. So I can either punt and, you know, be a jerk and leave the room, or I can just make the most of my time as well. So I usually, you know, I usually lean towards the latter of those two.
I feel like one of the things I try to do so hard when I'm doing an interview is to try to go in and find those questions. And so, okay, I don't want to ask this because if it's like the first 10 hits on Google, like, come on, you know what I mean? Do a little bit of homework or something.
I don't know. I mean, if you ask me something and I recoil, I'll let you know.
Like, did the Robinson brothers fight?
But I also understand that's what's, you know, people still ask Keith Richards about waking up in the middle of the night and writing Satisfaction. You know, do you think he cares? It's like, it's still something people think about, you know, but now that you say that, the ZZ Top, why did you get fired from ZZ Top? You know, we learned a lesson, or we should have learned a lesson early on when that happened, which is people's first impression is never going to go away. And for an awful lot of people, the first time they really heard of the band was because we got fired from a tour. You know, that blew up. We were on the cover of Rolling Stone because of that. You know, it was 2 weeks after we did SNL, like all these things were happening. And then that was the cherry on top. And if you had told me then that you'll do interviews for decades where that comes up, you know, and people are like, what really happened? You know, it's mind blowing to me because I've said before, it's like asking me about my senior prom. I don't know. I haven't thought about it in 40 years, but you know, it's interesting. But at the same time, if someone doesn't know that story there, I understand why people are interested. But yeah, that's the one more than anything that, if anything else, I was just always so baffled by how much that one had the legs on that story is incredible.
And it's urban legend now, like all these years later. There are so many reasons, you know, that I've heard over the years. And I was just like, who cares, man? They got kicked off a tour. They got better tours after that.
It's the best thing that ever happened to us at the time.
Probably my second favorite album, I have to say, was Amorica. And there was always this, again, kind of like an urban legend kind of thing where it went around that there was like a movie made of sorts around the recording of the album. Like it was like kind of like a freak show movie. And the only reason I'm bringing this up is because people were just asking me about this the other day. And I said, you know, I was like, all I know is that there was a still of it on the back of the album cover and that there's a, what was it? I think it was like a promo video for Cursed Diamond that we saw like a little tiny clip of that. What was that that happened?
It was just a film. You know, we had tracked the record and we just had a costume party. We just set up the studio to look like a wild freak scene. And it was just a party where we were playing the new songs. And it was just to have for press. That's what it was. It was like to chop into pieces. It ended up being used in an EPK back in the day, electronic press kit. It was just footage to have, just something to do, really. And it never, I think maybe, I don't know, there might have been a thought that it would be a long form music video for some future date. But as far as I know, nothing really ever came of it. The footage is just all somewhere.
That was another one that, like, there were so many rumors and legends. Oh my God, it was an orgy. And oh my God, it was like a giant coke party or whatever.
It was definitely not an orgy. I would remember that.
That's amazing. And also I got to tell you, I loved your book, Steve. That was, for a long time fan of not even so much just the Black Crowes, but of you, because, you know, I grew up a bass player. I was a bass player from the time I was like 14 until I was 20, 21. And every bass player wants to work with a dream drummer, you know? And when I saw you at Center Stage that first time, my first thought was, oh my, I would do anything to have a drummer like that. And so as you kind of like formulated your sound, and then you started going into the book about like your relationship with Johnny Colt. And one of the things that stuck out to me that I remember the most was that you guys were such a good team. Like that. I mean, you locked in, the feel was there, especially as you progressed, like going into Southern Harmony and then even into Amorica, where, you know, he was using his fingers and stuff, and you could really tell you guys were locked in. When he left, I mean, you even called him the, I think it was the heart and soul of the Black Crowes for the most part. And like, I'm trying to remember how you worded it, or maybe it was that he had big heart or something like that. I'm trying to remember the quote.
I don't remember that specifically. I said that he won the Black Rose when he left. I know.
That's what it was.
That was just more about his depart, you know, how he was able to leave in a good headspace as opposed to just about everybody else who wasn't able to pull themselves out of it before leaving. No, we were a great team. The whole band was a great team for a while there, you know, but Johnny and I specifically, and a lot of that was probably because he joined right before we made the first record. So we felt like we had to make up for lost time. Like all of a sudden we had this record, Shake Your Moneymaker was a way better record than we were band. You know, George pulled the best possible version of us out, had it on tape. And then we had to become that band. We had to live up to the record we'd made. And for me and Johnny, it was real simple, which is just, well, everybody's got work to do. And our job is to just lock down and have this really solid foundation for them to, for everyone else to be able to do that. So that was definitely by design. We were 100% aware of the fact that we had to get, you know, that we had to be rock solid and airtight so that everybody else could figure out how to do their thing as well as they could do it. You know, so from we saw ourselves as the bottom, like from the ground up, we got to build this thing.
Is growing like that with a bass player for you as a drummer too? I mean, what do you find harder or more exciting to actually grow, like you said, from the bottom up, or would it have been more fun or to like be able to jump right into it?
Oh no, it's all about, you know, the journey is the thing. I mean, setting your sights on something. It could be as simple as listening to, you know, Let There Be Rock or Sticky Fingers and going, we got to be like that. Like we got to lock in like that, you know, listening back to yourself 2 years later and recognizing, you know, we'd listen to a live tape from 90 and then listen to a live tape in 93. It sounds, and it's not just me and Johnny, but everybody sounded like we're on a different planet. We had all grown so much, you know, the quest is always the thing. It's not about getting anywhere. It's about being on the way to somewhere. I think that's usually, I'm most excited at this thought of a project or of a goal in mind. You know, reaching a goal is great, but the first thing you better do if you don't want to stay sane is set a new goal. You know, it's all about the journey.
To me, I would think that would be the more exciting part, would be to watch yourself grow as a team, as opposed to getting somebody who can come in and be like, oh, I learned the songs already. Well, it's like, where's the fun of that kind of working together and growing?
Yeah, no, that's another one of those things that as it was happening, it wasn't, we're not thinking about it consciously much at all on any level, but you certainly look back and it seems pretty clear.
I mean, like I said, following the Crows from 90 on, you know, we got to that point where once, Lions came out, then the band went on hiatus. Then they came back with a different drummer. It was Bill Dobrow. Bill Dobrow comes in. Fills the slot. I saw two shows with him. He was excellent. And then, of course, you returned to the throne. I was super excited because that magic came back. How did it feel to come back? Were you a little reluctant at first to come back because of various reasons? And
Sure. I haven't thought about that. And so the good thing about writing the book is I don't have to think about any of this crap. It's all in there. And so whatever I wrote explains it. And I've been able to not carry around anything that, you know, it was all in my head forever. And then I wrote it. Now it's all gone, thankfully. It was just always about trying to, it didn't make sense until it did. And then after a while, it didn't make sense again. You know, it was just kind of a redo of everything that had already happened, you know. And I really don't think of it I don't think of any of this stuff these days.
Yeah.
I mean, when you just asked that question, I was just like, oh, God, I haven't thought about anything from, that's almost 20 years ago, the second time around. So again, that's like asking me about my senior prom at this point.
I've been a total fan of your post-Crows material. Trigger Hippie was a game changer for me, man. That album, that first album was so good. And you had that lineup, but it's this newer lineup with Amber Woodhouse that it's almost like that. It's a little more stripped down. It's a less overwhelming presence, I think. And it really gave me some focus more so on the music.
Well, I think without any master design at all, that first version of Trigger Hippie was a lot to that point. I mean, you had a lot, it was a lot of personalities and three of whom already who come to a band with a whole lot of preconceived notions in anybody who's checking the band out. I mean, if you know who I am, if you know who Jackie is, if you know who Joan is, you're going to see that band and go, wow, what is all this? It was a band, but it was made up of some really large individual pieces, if that makes sense. And I'm talking about this from the perspective of listeners, not my perspective or not theirs, like not the people in the band, but the way the band can easily be perceived.
Right.
Because I think so much of how people look at bands is subconscious. It's subliminal. You don't realize you're having notions until they're disproven. Usually that's with anything in life. Mm-hmm. You know, you learn about yourself when something points out, oh, I didn't know I was even thinking that till I realized I was wrong. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We make a lot of assumptions, I guess, is what I'm saying. So whatever people thought of that first lineup of the band, at the end of the day, it was just a really good band, you know, and we had a bunch of good songs. And I was, you know, we were all for a time that was just really fun and easy thing to be doing together. And I'm very proud of that album. I thought it was, you know, under the circumstances and everything that was going on in the world, that we were able to put that record together and get it out and go tour a bunch in 14 and 15 was great. It was a lot of fun. And then as things do, and as careers evolve, you know, it was an untenable situation to keep that lineup together. I think if there was any focus the second time around from us, it wasn't so much a reaction at all to, it wasn't a reaction as much as it was just an awareness of what Nick and I really always wanted, which is just a really straight, cohesive, I can't tell you what it is, but I can tell you that we're all on the same page. That's all I'm ever looking for in anything is I just want to have a project where everybody's facing. You don't have to look each other in the eye and agree, but you got to be able to face the same direction and move forward together. You know what I mean? Like that's cohesion. That's the idea of a win to me is just everybody, even if you're moving really slowly, if you're all moving in the same direction, then you're, again, that journey is worth taking. And so with the second line, the different lineup for the second album and touring, it was just all about, let's just find a new thing. We can't recreate what that other band was. You know, that's a hamster wheel. That's not interesting. You know, let's go find something new that is what it is. And we'll incorporate some of those old songs as much as makes sense, but there's probably some that won't make sense to keep with us. Right. And, you know, that's no different than any band goes through when you change members. You know, you lose one or two people, you gain one or two people. And if it sounds like the same band, then you're really not doing anything that interesting, probably.
One of the things I loved about the Trigger Hippie album, the first one, was that, you know, when I first heard about the project, I've been a Joan Osborne fan for years. You know, Jackie Greene, I was a fan of. And in my mind, I was like, those are two very distinct and almost kind of strong personalities artistically.
Yeah, very much so.
But when I heard that album, kind of like what you said, there was that sense of cohesion that made me so surprised that it felt like the songs were bigger than the parts that were behind them, if that makes sense.
Well, sure. If that's whatever works for you, you know, I mean, again, I haven't listened to that record in a while, and just like the other stuff, I haven't thought about those days much, but I just know that at the time it felt great, you know, and it was very real. And, that was progressing along very nicely. You know, it struck us by surprise. The one thing I can tell you about that is that Nick and I called Joan and asked if she was interested in jamming and throwing this around. I said, I got a bass player who writes great songs and we're putting this thing together. And we got together with Joan a couple times, and then Jackie was coming through town and we just clicked up with him, and we didn't have some idea of, oh, a male and female singer. That wasn't like on paper. It was just, we got in a room and they started singing together and they were having a blast. And all of a sudden it was like, hey, let's see where this goes, you know? So, you know, as much as we may have had an idea of what we thought the band was, sometimes something comes along you don't expect and you just follow that because it's like, oh, that's a spark. And I think it was a great thing. Again, I obviously Jackie and Joan would both answer this more better than I could because we're talking about them. But I think for both of them, they were, I think everybody was surprised by how much fun it was just to, mm-hmm. to for them to play off each other. It was something they were both clearly not anticipating and really happy to discover.
So when that lineup came to fruition, was there an expectation of like, this is going to be the band? Or was it kind of gone into knowing that, okay, this is going to be what it is for right now? And it may even be a revolving door at some point.
Well, if we had all been in mm-hmm. our 20s, that would have been the band. You know, we would have gone out and done it like every band does, and then we would have all driven each other crazy. Because nobody was in their 20s, I think we were just happy. I mean, I think the thinking was, this will be great if this works long term, but with the reality of an understanding, we're talking about two people who already have really, really successful solo careers. Like, it's not like, I don't know that band would have ever been something to right. become full time for anybody, like full on full time. And again, even that is almost 10 years removed now, you know? So it's like, I have to really put my head back there, and there's no point. I mean, it just was what it was. And while it lasted, it was great.
So another thing I was curious to ask you was that, because you actually kind of went there a little bit, is that, you know, when you're younger and you're putting a band together and you're kind of going in like, this is the band, we're going to go, we're going to make it, whatever. Doing it later in life, I would assume that, because I kind of felt this way myself about my music and band that I put together or whatever, is that it seems a little easier because you have less expectations for anything more than just making music.
Well, finding something that clicks and makes mm-hmm. you feel good is such a nice surprise. But you also have, you've got realistic expectations along with, I would hope, much mm-hmm. sharper discernment. You know, you recognize what's bullshit and what's nonsense and what's not. You know, you don't chase bad ideas for songs. You know, everybody, you kind of recognize right away, right, like, oh, this, there's nothing here, you know, and you recognize, you know, you might have something in mind. Or, I can just tell you with Bagmen, like the group, Nick and Luther and I, we just recorded a bunch of songs, and there was a few songs that we had demos of that I thought, there was two of them where I was like, oh, I know that's going to be the one, man. We got in a room, and as soon as we started playing them, there's just nothing happened. You could tell mm-hmm. there was not a communal click, and two songs that I was convinced were just sort of mm-hmm. throwaways exploded. And so, you know, the difference between now and 20 years ago is we didn't spend one second trying to force something that wasn't feeling right into feeling right. We just went with what felt right, and everyone's much happier, and it sounds great, feels cool. You know, there's a million things. It's just like anything else in life. The more you do it, if you're doing it right, the more you do it, the better you get at it, the more efficient you become. And the more you can appreciate the very little things, and you can ignore a lot of things that at one time would have felt really big and important because you recognize they're really not.
So I love what I've seen and the little bit I've seen and heard of Bagmen. And I was excited because kind of just encapsulated that old school. And I hate to go with the jam thing, so I'm not going to say jam band because I don't think it is, but it's that kind of era of music, you know what I mean? Where it's that kind of, it's got some funk, it's got some blues, it's got like a lot of that crossover. And
yeah,
I'm assuming that connection with Luther kind of came from his time in the Crows. So that must have been a really tight thing that you formed with him to want to work with him later.
Yeah, oh, for sure. And we've been talking about this for years. You know, this is something that Luther mm-hmm. and I, you know, Nick had a couple of restaurants in Nashville for years. There was one he had called Kitchen West Side, a little tiny place. He could fit about 15 people in there. And Luther and I used to go, Luther and I would go there. We'd meet there for lunch back in 2015, 2016. Mm-hmm. So that's going back a ways. Or maybe it was 16 and 17, but whenever it was, you know, we would see each other there. And so it'd just be, you know, and Nick would be behind the counter and the two of us would be sitting there, and there'd be times when there's no one else in the joint. We're just listening to music and, you know, eating lunch and talking about this. You know, what turned into be Bagmen was just a conversation about, man, we should do something, and we should, you know, let's play something that's kind of just works to both our strengths, and how do we want to do it? And, you know, Luther and Nick knew each other before I knew either one of them. You know, they met in the 90s with Nick's old band High Water, playing with a very young All Stars. So it was just they, you know, so they go back farther than I go back with either guy. So it was just a very easy conversation to have. Wouldn't it be cool if we did this type of thing, which, you know, you have with other musicians all the time. This one always did feel like there was a little bit more to it. And then finally, you know, a million things happen and then a million things clear off everyone's schedules. And you're like, okay, let's do this now. So that's what now is.
One of the rare things that I feel like happens that Bagman has done lately, or now I should say, is that most bands come out and they're like throwing songs out left and right. Like, here's the first single. Here's the second single. We got like a jam from you guys, like a jam video. I thought that was actually a really smart move on your part, because that drum, at least for me, that drummed up the curiosity to go, okay, I've got to keep my eyes out on this and see what's coming. Was that an intentional thing, or?
I'm hardly a social media expert. You know what I mean? You know, that's just one of those, you've talked to somebody who knows what they're doing and they say, this would be a good idea. And like, okay, thanks. Why don't you hook that up for us? Well, Bagman doesn't have a master plan beyond some shows this year. And we certainly hope we have some shows next year. It's just real simple. Like, again, we've been talking about this for a long time. We got to the studio and it went as well as, if not way better than we had hoped. And then right away we got some offers for gigs and it's just like, yeah, let's go see, let's go check it out. Mm-hmm. And again, 30 years ago, I'd be gassing up the van and saying, let's go. We'll see you next year. You know, not something I'm going to be doing right now. It's not something, you know, we'll just see what happens with it. And obviously we want people to like it. I'm sure people will. It'll be, you know, we'll have a good time and people will dig it. But but it's all about the fact that we're just putting something together with new energy and a whole different sort of vibe, and it's a lot of fun. It's literally that simple. It's just, this is cool. Let's do this.
It's just great for me to see you having so much fun playing music again. I'm sure you're like me in the same way that, you know, I'm very passionate about the musicians and the bands that I love. So part of you gets kind of almost personally invested sometimes in certain musicians and what they're doing and how they're doing it.
Sure.
And so to see you, especially with, you know, like I said, post Crows, you know, going in, you know, with the Trigger Hippie albums, and now you got Bagman, and it warms my heart to see one of my favorite musicians still having so much fun, in the sense that, like, it doesn't feel like you're even tapping out yet. If anything, you're finding new energy.
Oh yeah. It's interesting. I've had several people say just in the last few months out of the, someone will say, oh, do you still play? And I'm always so surprised by that question. I'm like, so I still play? Why would I stop? What are you talking about? Like, and I get it. Like, I've been doing radio for a decade now, or over a decade, you know, and I've been doing, I mean, it's almost 10 years of national radio. So yeah, I understand that people might assume that means I'm not, but I'm still a drummer who does other things. I mean, the first way I describe myself and think of myself is I'm a drummer. You know, everything else is next to that. Now I have with doing a morning radio show in Minneapolis, like I am, I mean, this is a very real, the first time I ever thought to myself, like, I'm really a radio, like I had a sports talk show for almost 5 years on Fox Sports Radio, but I still didn't think I was a radio guy first, you know. That was still just too close, being on the heels of just playing, doing nothing but drumming for so long. But now I see it. It's like, yeah, I'm if you call me a radio guy who's a drummer, that's fine. I see myself as a drummer who does radio, but really at the end of the day, it's, you know, I'm doing more radio than drumming, but that's just because of the reality of what it is to drum these days. But I'm still playing all the damn time. I'm just not playing publicly so you can go see it, you know, but there's it's all the same to me. If I'm not sitting at the drum kit, I'm listening to records playing in my head. And the next time I get at that kit, I'm going to go rip off all the cool stuff I just heard. I mean, that never changes.
I also think it depends on the perspective of the people, you know, like if more people know you from the radio aspect, they're going to say, oh, you're the radio dude who I heard played drums in a band. Yeah. Whereas like someone like me, would be like, you know, that's fucking Steve Gorman, dude. That's like one of the best rock and roll drums. Oh yeah. He has a radio show too. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I just, you know, I don't, a lot of the time when I talk about stuff like that, I'm just, trying to put my head in the perspective of other people, because to me, the less I think about any of that, the better I feel. You know what I mean? I just get up every day and I'm like, what am I going to do today? What's on the list? And I go do it. And I like to be busy. And I, you know, I just do things I like to do. I mean, I still, you know, I don't have some grand master plan of, you know, like radio, I started it later in life. So, I mean, someone just said the other day, like, because I was a broadcasting major in college, I thought I was going to be a sportscaster. That was my plan at 19 and 20, so I'd be a sportscaster.
Right, yeah.
And someone said, man, where do you think you'd be if you had never dropped out of school and just stayed in broadcasting? And I was like, I imagine I'd be one of those guys who jams in the basement with friends. You know, like I would have gotten a drum kit and I would have taught myself, gotten pretty good, or a little bit anyway. And I'd be, you know, doing something in the world of broadcasting. I mean, the only two things I ever really thought about doing were drumming in a band and broadcast and being on the radio. So, I, you know, and for the last 12, 13 years, I've been doing both after 30 years of just doing the first. And, you know, so it's just what it is. You know, it's just I think my strengths in both are that I focus on what I'm good at and I don't get too close to the lines that I know aren't, you know. I know what I am as a drummer. I know what I am as a broadcaster, and I don't try to do things I'm not good at.
And that is part of keeping an artistic ego in check also. You know what I mean? Like to say like, you know, oh, I'm not going to throw myself out there.
Oh, I could never be. I mean, I can say, I said to someone this morning, the producer of my radio show here in Minneapolis, my producer of the morning show, he was listening to one of the Bagman tracks and he goes, God, I mean, this sounds dumb, but you're a really good drummer. You know, like he was kind of laughing. And I said, oh yeah, I know. I said, I think I'm great, you know, but, and then I said what I just told you, which is I'm great just because I know what I'm good at and I don't deviate. Like I'm not going to go be in a Rush cover band. You know what I mean? If you want to expose me, ask me to go play a samba beat. You know, go there's a million things that I'm not, that I couldn't do well and that I'm not interested in doing, thankfully. You know what I mean? I don't have I have a drive to be really good at what I'm good at. You know, I'm still getting better. I think I'm a better drummer right now than I've ever been. I really do think that. You know, I've just learned more and that's all I want. I just want to be a rock and roll drummer. And I still have a lot of places I need to probably go or that I can go in there and that I certainly am not shying away from, but I also know that somebody the other day said something like you should only work on chops or rudiments. Oh, you know, for any musician, you only got to go back and dig in. If you can't play what you hear, then go back to the drawing board. And I just thought, wow, I can play everything I hear. Like I always, I just apply a certain, and the way I drum and the stuff I do, that's much wider than it was 20 years ago. But compared to a lot of drummers, it's still a very straight shot. You know, I'm just the drummer I am. And I think I have a really keen understanding of what that is. So it's just not ever really a concern. There's just not too many things that come up where I go. I mean, I do have ideas that I then have to figure out how to do it and how to do it naturally. Mm-hmm. And I'll literally go sit and for, you know, a cumulative number of hours, I'm just working on a thing, on a specific vibe or a feel that I might never even use, but I just know I'm going to need it someday or I'll want to use it someday. But for the most part, when I'm playing, I'm just me, the way I play and the way I hear music.
So do you think that growth that you were just talking about from like being able to hear it, to play it, to your style growing and whatnot, would that have grown in the same way had you not been having the experience of being a touring band and playing with other bands?
Oh no, not a chance. No, that's it all came from the road. I mean, it came from being in a band that was for a while there in the 90s, ludicrously ambitious, writing really weird songs and bizarre time changes. A band that decided to just jam completely improvisationally in front of an audience every night instead of doing it at soundcheck. You know, I got to be very quick and very, very light on my feet, very sharp with that sort of in that context. I would have never, you can't do that. I could have never become the drummer I was if I had been just playing weekends and working a day job. because I'm never going to sit in a basement and play. I hate playing drum. I don't like playing drums. I like playing music. And music, that means there's a guy with a guitar and a bass in the room with me, you know, going in and playing. And I do play now pretty regularly. I sit at the kit for an hour several times a week right now. And I enjoy it, but it's just keeping myself in shape. It's making sure my hands and my wrists feel okay. And then hearing a few, you're working through a few little ideas, maybe a groove in my head I'm trying to make sense of. But if somebody who knows five chords on guitar comes in and plugs in next to me, I'm going to have a whole lot more fun.
You know, and that's something to be said about that kind of feeling when it comes to playing music, because for myself, I was never one of those guitar player kids who sat in my room and practiced scales.
Yeah.
I couldn't play a scale if my life depended on it, mm-hmm. but I could play just about every fucking AC/DC song. Do you know what I mean? And so to me, it was more fun, more fulfilling to, like you said, to actually have people in a room make, I didn't want to be a guitar player. I wanted to be a musician.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted to make music. I wanted to write music and play. You know, I didn't want to be Steve I, you know, I wanted to be Malcolm Young, you know, it's a big difference. And
it's hard to be Malcolm if you don't have Phil and Cliff.
Again, right goes back to that whole concept of that perfect rhythm section.
Yeah.
And I feel like you have that with this project.
Oh, well, Nick and I have played, my bassist Nick and, you know, Trigger Hippie and Bagman, we've been playing together since 2004. The first time we ever played was just at a jam at a bar in East Nashville. And we played for a few hours, just winging it completely. And that night we sat there afterwards drinking beer. And I remember I said, like, we sound like a band. Like, we don't sound like two guys jamming. We sound like we already play together.
Mm-hmm.
Or I should say it felt that way. Cause it's all, and it really was there from the jump. I mean, I've played with a lot of great bassists and I, you know, think so highly of so many great musicians I've played with. There's only a few times in life when you have a connection that the more you talk about it, the less you want to talk about it. You know, it's like, I don't talk about the way Nick and I play together that much because it says everything for itself. Like the, you know, that is one of those things. We're so copacetic, and that's playing music and just hanging out. You know, we're very, very close. And so it's one of the true luxuries of my life is that I don't have to think about that. Like if we get in a room and start, if we play together, it's going to feel great. It's just, I don't give it a second thought. It's great.
With you and Nick together, that was one of those things where I felt like myself. I said, if that was me, I would do everything I could to keep that going.
Yeah.
You know, like regardless of where you're going. And it sounds so fluid. And coming out of all that weirdness with the Crows and stuff, like that's the kind of shit that a lot of times breaks a person, breaks a musician.
Sure.
How hard was it, if hard at all, for you to flip that into the positivity that carried you into this place where you are ultimately happy Steve Gorman right now?
Well, I mean, I think I've been happy Steve Gorman for a while. The 90s were the hard years, you know, for me. By the time when the second go round for the Black Crows, in a lot of ways it was a more difficult environment, but I was much better at handling it. I didn't take it home with me. You know, that I recognize that this has nothing to do with me. It really doesn't. You know, it's just, it turned into a job and it was a great job. It was pretty simple. I just was able to recognize where the lines were, even if no one else could see them. I saw my own lines. And that's not to say every day was easy or anything. I didn't have all the answers, but I was just in a much healthier place. So when the band, you know, and again, now we're talking, it's been 10 years since I was on a road with the Black Crows. When I made the decision in February of 2014 that I would never again be on the road with the Black Crows, it was an easy door to close because I had just started this new radio show. Trigger Hippie was already out playing shows. We had finished our album that was about to be released. I mean, I had set myself up for that very day to be like done with that. So it's really been, but you know, which is not to say I haven't had moments along the way where I recognized, oh, I'm reading something wrong out of habit, or I'm looking at this I'm expecting the negative just because that's what I'm used to. And so, and those things do take a while to 100% filter through. You just can't, it's just a process, I guess. But generally speaking, I've been, you know, I don't remember, again, I'm not suggesting I walk around every day with a rainbow shooting out of my ass, but I've felt pretty darn good about things for a long time, you know?
I read a couple of interviews with you as neurodivergence and music, like being OCD, ADHD or whatever. How is it that stuff can sometimes work in our favors as musicians, as opposed to cripple us?
Oh, the OCD thing for me was incredibly advantageous. You know, every drummer has their own clock, their own meter, I guess, you know, you got a clock ticking and I'm in touch with that. And so I'm going to tell you where the one is, but I'm always going to know if I'm ever ahead or behind it. And I can't turn that off. You know, like if you want to speed up, I'm going to really try hard to keep you from doing that. If you're slowing down, I'm going to try hard to keep you from doing that. And I don't even, again, these aren't conscious things. It's just my internal thing of like, I'm here to establish this. And I think when I was, now I don't have other OCD, I don't have OCD tendencies anymore. I've, you know, nothing like a couple of complete nervous breakdowns to rid you of some of those things and get you to face the reason you have them in the first place. But when I learned how to drum, I certainly did. And, you know, I also, you know, when I learn a lesson, I tend to not need to be reminded of it. And early in my drumming days, you know, when I first got to Atlanta, I was 21 when I started, I recognized some very basic things really quickly, which was, if you're going to play fills, you better really know where you're going before you get into the middle of it. You know, I was watching other local drummers that were really good, but then they would just lose time in a fill. And I could just see the faces of their bandmates and I could feel it like, oh, they don't like that, you know? And like, you know, like stamina is a big thing. Like you've got to be able to play the whole show. You can't get weak towards the end. I would watch bands fall apart, you know, because they just run out of gas. I mean, you're all basic things, but when you're first trying to be in your own band and you're going to see bands now with a very different lens, I'm not seeing them because I think it's cool to see bands. I'm like trying to learn something every night. I'm wondering what they do that I should do. I'm wondering what they do that I shouldn't do. Some real basic things I learned, you know, everybody likes playing with a drummer that they don't have to think about, you know, I mean, I guarantee you, like, you know, if you're in a band with a great drummer, you love your drummer, you're happy he's there, but it only takes a few shows before you're back to being like, man, I'm going to take this guitar solo out. And if the drummer's doing their job, and if that guitar player never has to look back to make sure he's in time with you, he's going to play better. Now you might play too much and then you might have a fight afterwards, but the drummer's job is to, you know, like I learned very early on, I would just watch bands and I was like, man, the drummers who are rock solid, it just seems like everyone else on stage is happier than the guys whose drummers aren't rock solid. It's real simple. It's like your job is just to make everybody else as good as they can be, you know, at a certain point, that's job one. And then job, you know, then you can think about, well, what about what I want to play and what about this and what about that? But, you know, a band is only as good as its drummer, of course. And, you know, job one is just give no one a reason to turn around. That's what I used to think. Like if no one looks back at me, the whole set, because when they do that, they're going, what the hell's going on back there? That's why they're looking back. If I can play a 40-minute set and no one looks at me from my own band, then I just won the game.
Exactly.
It's pretty simple stuff, really.
You know, you also had a great way of being so very creative with drum parts, in the sense that you would do some really cool things. And just to hear the growth, like from, you know, Shake Your Money Maker, where you were just like, you were really solid, good, hard hitting rock drummer, you know, Southern Harmony, you had, you know, that little solo in Sting Me that you did, which kind of showed your swing and some flair. But then you got to like Amorico, where you had that incredible like thing that you do during Wiser Time, which even though I'm not a drummer, I could never figure out what you were doing, you know? So are those things that you would just kind of formulate on your own before going into a song? Or was that something that once you got set into the song, you were like, okay, I think this is how it should sound?
It's always just different. I mean, some songs you just, the first thing you play is perfect. And some songs you try 50 things and you still never feel like you get it right. You know, I can tell you that at that time in the Black Crowes, we were playing so much. We never were away from each other. We soundchecked for hours at a time. We were constantly holding our instruments in each other's presence, you know, and so there's no, you know, if somebody says to me, I came up with that idea, I'll go, okay, cool. I don't remember specifically. There's a few. To your Wiser Time point, I was playing that part at like hyperspeed, just fucking around, almost like a Devo beat would be. And Chris looked at me and said, hey, slow that down. And then I played that. And then he goes, hey, Rich, play that thing you were playing yesterday. And Rich just laid the chords over top of it. And suddenly there's Wiser Time. And so that was just a great moment of Chris hearing some weird pattern that was unlike something I'd done before. And then thinking about something Rich had been playing around with and seeing if they fit. And they did. And then we were off and running, you know. But again, that's what happens when you're always together. You know, when a band is just constantly working, you can pull, you can finish each other's sentences in a way. So that's the, you know, the strength of that era was that exact, that's a perfect example of why that band was where it was. You know, and every situation's different, you know, with, I can tell you that with Bagmen, the difference with what we just recorded and anything from those days was there wouldn't have been any, hey, that thing you did yesterday, because we just moved on. If something clicked, we just did it and knocked it out. And if it didn't, we just, you know, we're just like buzzsawing through it. Because we all know what feels good. There's, you don't go back the next day and go, let's listen again and make sure that was good. We just know it's yes or no, move on or stay. And, but you know, it's all, it, and if Bagmen goes out and plays 150 shows next year, we'll probably have stories like that first one I told, but right now we're where we are. And all of this is a long-winded way to say, you just got to be, you as a musician, you're just where you are. You know, sometimes, sometimes the last record you heard really makes an impact on what you play. And sometimes the last sandwich you ate does that. You just never know if you're open to it. You know, inspiration can come from anywhere.
So Bagmen's got some shows coming up. What are we going to expect? Is there going to be some music released before you do the shows? Or are the shows going to be where we're going to really hear Bagmen for the first time?
We would like to get a song or maybe even two. No promises, but that's our thought right now. But if not, then, you know, you just got to take a chance, come out and see some, come out and see the band. See, I think anybody who shows up will have a good time.
Is that a little nerve wracking for you? Or is there a level of excitement knowing that that may be the first time?
Not in the least.
Yeah.
No. I mean, we're playing our first gig in a couple of days up in Wisconsin. That, you know, that's at a big brewery summer party. There's going to be like 4,000 people there. You know, we've all played enough gigs. We're going to be okay. It's not, it is exciting. I mean, I'm very excited. I can't wait. Yeah. I mean, we're rehearsing this week. I'm thrilled to be rehearsing. It's going to be a blast. But nothing about it's nerve wracking.
It's exciting. Well, Steve, I am super excited for it. The show is going to be on June 28th at Smith's in the Atlanta Room. And, congratulations for playing on the same stage that I played on at some point.
It's been a goal for many years, my friend.
Well, Steve, like I said, congratulations with Bagmen. And it's great. And it was such a great time talking to you. I really enjoyed this. And thank you for flattering this old fan, man.
Yeah, right on, dude. Thank you.